right, is everybody ready?
Levon.
I'm satisfied with just the cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransomed will shine, I want a gold one, that silver line.
I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. Don't think me poor, a pilgrim in search of the city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where
let him know you are in his house this morning.
Good morning. Just to let everybody know, we took our annual trip to Six Flags yesterday with the youth. We left here with 15 children, Miss Margaret, Julie, and myself. Came back with 16 kids, Miss Margaret, Julie, and myself. So we dropped one off about halfway. Wasn't sure who he was, but he ended up with us somehow. For anybody that is interested, if you're planning on going to Six Flags, do not take cash. They do not accept cash in the park. We found that after the fact when we got in there yesterday. So they do have a way that you can convert your cash to a gift card or a Visa card. So if you're planning on going, don't take cash. They won't accept it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day, and we thank you for all the wonderful blessings that you've given to us. Lord, you know that we need the rain, and we thank you for this rain. Lord, we just thank you for this church and what this church is doing in this community and the light that we are for you. Lord, we just pray that you continue to guide us as a congregation. Guide us to follow you and to lead others closer to you. Lord, we just pray that you be with Charky and the band as they bring the worship and the message this morning. Lord, we just pray that you continue to direct our path each and every day. And we just ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. All right. Good morning, everybody.
Is it good to be in God's house? Amen. Let him know.
Amen.
Well, we're glad. Thank you, Charky. I appreciate that. God appreciated that, Charky. Well, rain scared a couple people off, but he knew exactly who was going to be here this morning. And welcome to the Lone Star Cowboy Church. Folks looking in, we're glad you're looking in. We saved a few spots. We can't wait to see you. Visitors, we're glad you're here. We hope you like the way we go about this, our style of worship here. But let's just have a good time in the Lord this morning. Amen. I'm going to get a good one out. I'm going to keep trying. In Psalms chapter 71, verse 8, my mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all the day. If you ask me if I'm happy, if I have sweet peace within, if I'm worried about tomorrow when I reach my journey's end, I'm satisfied with my Jesus. When he knocks, I'll let him in. He'll go with me through the valley, 'cause I know he is my friend. I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
No trouble can never get me down. For when my eyes are closed in death with my Jesus, I'll be at rest. And you'll know I'm satisfied. If my friends, they all forsake me, and they turn me from their door, if they sow no seeds of kindness, make the thorns in my path grow, well, it won't matter over yonder when I reach that other side. I'm gonna sit down with my Jesus. Satisfied, I'm satisfied. I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied. No trouble can ever get me down. For when my eyes are closed in death with my Jesus, I'll be at rest.
Then you'll know
I'm satisfied. Got that old time religion. Got that old time religion.
That is why
I'm satisfied. Yes,
that is why
I'm satisfied. Yeah. Amen.
Who at my door is standing? Patiently drawing near, entranced within, demanding, who is the voice I hear? Lonely without, he standing, lonely within am I. While I am still delaying, will he not pass me by? Sweet leader, tongues are falling.
Brother Tommy.
Thank you so much, Kevin. All praise is his this morning. In James chapter 4, verse 8, excuse me. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, dear Lord, close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toils and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, O Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. And time for me will be no more. Gently guide me safely, oh, to thy kingdom, dear Lord, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Just a closer walk with thee. Jesus is my plea.
Just a closer walk, just a closer walk.
Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Amen. Good job, Tommy. Thank you so much. Just that closer walk with the Sloan, you hanging in there? No voice this morning.
What key are we doing this next one in?
Well, let's see. What key do y'all want to do this in? We'll do it in G.
All righty.
No, we didn't give him any penalties. He got some stuff going on today, but we're glad everyone's here. All the folks are here. Glad you're here. And
if you're trying to reach heaven, you talk to Jesus. You talk to him every day. 'Cause Jesus knows. Oh, he knows that you are coming. And heaven's just a prayer away. Now if you go to church on Sunday, you get down on your knees and pray. Just when you think, oh, that you can make it all the time. Heaven's just, sorry about that, guys, a prayer away. You are just one prayer from heaven. And as you travel down life's highway, and just when you think, oh, that you can't make it, well, heaven's just a prayer away. Now if you go to church on Sunday, heaven's just a prayer away. Now if you go to church on Sunday, you get down on your knees and pray. Give your heart and your soul to Jesus, 'cause heaven's just a prayer away. 'Cause heaven's just a prayer away.
Didn't even know the allergy.
Way to muscle through that. Didn't you do a good job? Thank you so very much. All right. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. Amen. I'm going to keep going at you. And this is the victory that has overcome the world. Our faith. Mr. Tommy.
Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Tell me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can. can show someone else what I've been through myself. On my way back to you, Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
Amen. Praise God. Tommy, I believe that I've seen a lot of people singing that back. They must know that song. Amen.
It's old, like me.
All right, it's a good one. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Miss Candace.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Thank you.
Isn't that a beautiful, beautiful song? Amen. I've seen a few singing that one too, Candace. All right. One more here. In Revelations. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him and he with me.
Are my everything, and I will adore you.
of all that praise you've been storing up. Amen.
Amen. Wonderful. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, we just love you and we do adore you. Lord, we praise your name for who you are in our lives. We praise you for all the good that you provide us. Lord, we praise you for that still small voice that leads and guides and directs each and every day. We thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who fulfilled your call for his life. Poured his blood out for the salvation of your people. We praise you for that. Lord, we want to praise you, God, that you don't leave us here on this earth just to flail about on our own. But God, through that Holy Spirit, you lead and you guide and you direct. We thank you for those people in our lives that we love and that we can be loved by, Lord. And I thank you, God, for the opportunity that we have to live life together and to point our children and grandchildren to Jesus. Lord, we thank you, God, for what you're doing all around this wonderful earth that you created. The salvations and the revivals that are taking place all over foreign nations and even here in America. We thank you, Lord, that you're not done here on this earth, God, but you are still working amongst your people, changing lives and restoring hearts. We thank you, Lord, of redeemed spirits, God, people who have said yes to the Lord and their lives are changed, no longer chasing after the things of the world, but quietly, gently following their Lord and Savior. Lord, we want to thank you, God, that there will be a day when we stand before you. And we understand that this world is not over, but our life is just beginning. When you draw us up close to you and you say, well done, good and faithful servant, now come spend eternity forever with me. Lord, as Christians, that's what we believe. That's what our hope and trust is in. And so, Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. And we thank you for our eternity, heaven, with you. Be with our children today as they go to their class, Lord, and I pray that they would begin to truly understand the foundations of what being a Christian's all about. Help them, Lord, to have a desire to know you and to follow you even as young people. Help them, Lord, not to be influenced by the craziness of this world and the things that they're being bombarded with right now. But Lord, I pray that they would understand there's peace and there's joy and there's happiness when they follow Lord and a Savior. Father, for what you do, we praise you. And it's in the name of Jesus we ask these things. Amen. Well, we want to welcome each one of you here today, and we're going to be having a baptism right after the little meet and greet. Children, you're dismissed. Those who are getting baptized, if you would stay here, and then in just a minute, we will have you come up. Find somebody you don't know, shake their hand, make them feel welcome. We want to make sure everyone knows that they are welcome here. So you find that person that needs a handshake and give them a good, strong handshake, and we'll get started soon. All right, if you can make your way to your seat, we want to make you aware of a few of the announcements. While they're making their way. We were going to have a team roping today, but that's canceled. We got a regular Monday night service. We got a regular Tuesday night team roping if it's not too wet, which I think is going to be too wet. We got a regular Wednesday night service going on. So lots to do, lots taking place. And I'd like you to come and be a part sometime throughout this week of all the activities that do take place. If I can get you to make your way back up here. Now, I want y'all to know, if my sermon takes forever, it's not my fault. It's them back there. Y'all don't need to hear it. It's them guys who need to hear it. That's right. Elders, if you guys would come forward at this time. We got our women's group on Tuesdays at 2 o'clock. They got a wonderful group, many people from the community and from the church. They meet right here, so come be a part of that. I believe that you would enjoy that if you're a woman. If you're a guy, stay gone. Riley, we'd like to invite you up at this time. And Riley, it's my privilege to baptize Riley Freeman. Come on up, sweetie. She came to me a few weeks ago and said that she wanted to be saved. And so we prayed a sinner's prayer. And that was that I am in need of a Savior. And that's the prayer that she prayed in her life. And I'm so proud of you. And then was it last week or the week before that?
The week before that.
Week before that, she said she wanted to be baptized. So, Riley, we want you to know that we're so proud of you. And this is your church family, okay? And as you get to know us, it's going to be our privilege to get to know you. I loved the post that your mom put on Facebook with you holding the sign up says I love my church, and I think it was because you had a donut. Well, we're so glad you love your church, and we love you too. Okay, understand baptism is an outward sign of an inward experience that's already taken place in her heart. You see, inwardly she understood even as a child that she needed a Savior, and she asked the Lord to come into her heart. And that's already taken place. But baptism is an outward sign of an inward experience that's taken place. Today, she stands before you and she says, I am a Christian and I want my church family to know that. You understand that today, Riley? Okay, let's be baptized. Riley, as you step in that ice cold water. Not even cold, is it? I'm being silly. Okay, if you want to sit on your bottom, honey. You want to take your glasses off? Okay. Thank you. Riley, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the one who created a plan for your salvation so many years ago, and his Son, Jesus Christ, the one who fulfilled that plan by going to the cross. And the Holy Spirit, we baptize you in the name of the Holy Spirit, that still small voice that leads you and guides you and directs you as you go through down the road of life. Yeah. Well, amen. Her dad said dunk her twice, but I think that was plenty, right? All right, we love you, sweetie. You may just thank you, gentlemen. Well, Riley, we want to thank you for being an example to the rest of us of what it looks like to be obedient. And I want to challenge any of you, if you have not been baptized and you're a believer, then you need to do that. Scripture calls us to be baptized. He says that we're to be baptized. He doesn't say if you want to, but he says that we are to be baptized. So if you are somebody who has been here for 100 years and you just never done it, you would be embarrassed to think that people didn't realize you weren't baptized. I want you to fight all that stuff and say, I want to be obedient, just as Riley, in something such as baptism. Today we're going to be talking about something that is somewhat, in some ways it's very simple. In some ways it's things that we have learned for years, but yet then there's other ways that the world tries to tell us that we're not quite supposed to believe everything that Scripture says. And we've been indoctrinated through education, through the school systems for years that maybe everything the Bible says isn't quite true. true. And so we have to continually have an internal battle is, do I believe the Bible 100%? Or do I believe the Bible until it debates and challenges what science or what the world tries to make us believe? And so anyway, I want to talk about what is grace and how do we receive a firm foundation in grace, in saving grace. I want you to have a firm foundation. Many of you build houses. Many of you pour concrete. And if you were to go build a house, you'd create a good solid base. You wouldn't put it on the dirt. You wouldn't just build your house on the dirt. You wouldn't start with the roof and then work your way down. But you would build a solid foundation. And that's what I want you to understand, is a solid foundation as a Christian is a understanding of Genesis chapter 1. A good solid foundation of as a Christian is an understanding of how it all began. Because you see, if you don't agree with how it says the world began, then you might as well throw the rest of it out, because it all revolves around the foundation. This is the foundation of our faith in the Lord. So we're going to be going through a few scriptures, and we're just going to touch on a few scriptures. We're not going to do any long in-depth study on any particular scripture, but I want us to begin to understand what is salvation and what are we saved from? You see, a lot of people today, when you say, you talk about God, to us or to a Christian people, we think of Jehovah God. We think of God, the one who created the heavens and earth. But a lot of people today, when you say God, is you go into our local schools and you say God, they have to ask themselves, what God are you talking about? Are you talking about the Christian God? Are you talking about the Muslim God? Are you talking about philosophy? What are you talking about? What God? You see, to us, for many of us who are maybe a little bit older, we grew up with a foundation of who that God was. When we talked about sin, if you grew up in church if you got a little gray in your hair, you grew up with a culture, with a country that understood some of the biblical truths, what sin was, who God was, our need for a savior. But church, you got to understand, in today's young people, they don't understand that. They don't know what sin is. What is sin? What is sin? What am I being saved from? I don't get it. Why don't they get it? Because they didn't grow up with the same foundation that we have had. I'm captivated by a prayer that one of the teachers prayed at the last prayer meeting that we had there at the high school. In her prayer, she said this: the life of a child, of a young person today, the family life of a young person today is not the same that it was 50 years ago. That's kind of a very aha moment that captivated me, because we always think it's just exactly like it was when we were children. In church, the reason we see so many kids leaving the gospel, they get out of high school and they leave. They're no longer a part of the church. That there's a mass exodus taking place in the church right now with that generation of people. And the reason is, I think, is because we really don't have a good understanding. We don't have a good foundation. We can't have and ever answered the questions. We've allowed the school system to not only teach our kids math and arithmetic, but we've also let them indoctrinate our children into, well, that's what the Bible says, but this is real history. When you're talking about Old Testament stories with your children, what do you call them? I just did. Old Testament what? Stories. Fairy tales. But church, we've got to understand, when we're teaching about the Old Testament, we're not telling stories. We are telling history. See, that's quite different, because if I'm just telling you a story, well, the stories ain't always true, especially if they come from, I don't know, Jeremy. That wasn't funny. Stories ain't always true. And our children come to church and they see beautiful pictures of Noah's Ark and the boat's little and the elephant's fat and the boat's about to sink, and we think that's a story. And when our teacher says the world's been around millions of years, they begin to think that is fact. The little fat elephant in the little boat, that's a story. But this is what we're told is truth. And for generations now, that's what our kids have been taught. Many of us have heard some of the same things, and we walk away going, so where is the truth? We've got to have a firm foundation. You see, people, we're not ever going to be able to understand what sin is if we don't understand what we're saved from. So I want you to understand Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, God made everything. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. This is a 7-day period. It's not a long portion. Each day is not a time, isn't a span of time. It's a literal 7 days. In 7 days, God created the earth. On the seventh day, he rested. At the beginning, on the first day, God began creation. In the beginning, that means at the very first, God created. Some people want to say, well, it's a long span of time. Who says that a day is just a day? But even Jesus himself talked about the fact that a day of that time was just a day. There's many scriptures, and I don't want to prolong on any one of these specific facts. In fact, I'm excited to share with you that I'm just going through a very brief introduction. But in July, I think it's 24th, 25th, whatever that Sunday is, I have a guy that's coming from the Answers of Genesis. The Answers in Genesis program, who's going to come and talk about things such as creationism versus evolution. Where's dinosaurs fit in all this? He's going to come and he's going to share those things. We're going to have a 2-part message. We're going to have our Sunday morning regular service. Then we have an eat and meet in that afternoon. And then we're going to have a second part on that. It's going to be very, very interesting. And you want your children to be here so they can understand some of these things more clearly. But in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, it says, God created the heavens and the earth. There was no life before this moment. Understand, there was no life before in the beginning. In the beginning means just that, in the beginning. And in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, it says, now the earth was formless and empty. And God said, let there be. And it was at the power of his word, let there be, the earth began to form in literal 1-day increments. You see, it says things like there was the sun came up and the sun set, right? After the creation of light. That's 1 day. Secondly, I want you to understand in Genesis 1 verse 31, we learn that God made everything perfect. Say perfect. Perfect. You women, I believe it. Guys, I don't know. You women are pretty perfect. No death, no suffering. In the beginning, God made everything perfect. No death, no suffering. When God made these things. When God made the earth. Genesis chapter 1 verse 31 says this. Then God saw everything he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. The world's greatest perfectionist was happy with what he created. He didn't look down upon it and say, average at best. He didn't look down upon it and say, I could have done better. He looked down upon it and said, very good. It was not just good, it was very good. The skies, the earth, the waters, the plants, the animals, and the humans were very good. Church, I want you to understand, ancient man was not idiots. Ancient man did not beat themselves with clubs. Ancient man was highly intelligent. We are not smarter now. We are not smarter now. We've got more things now, but we are not more intelligent now than what we were from then. Because remember, God said, let's make man in our what? In our own image. He did not make Neanderthal. He made highly intelligent men and women. High intelligence. I think that's, it's easy to see the truth in that when you just think of ancient man with the pyramids, ancient man with the things that they created. What does the History Channel tell us? They were so intelligent, were able to do such amazing things, there's no way they could have done it. So who must have done it? Aliens. Alien History Channel talks about aliens coming down and doing these things. And ancient alien, remember, isn't that what they call that show? Ancient alien, something like that. It had to have been aliens. Because there's no way that ancient Neanderthal hit themselves in the head with clubs men could have created such masterpieces. Man was highly intelligent. Man was created in his own image. Man had perfect health. They were critical thinkers and they had perfect love. God made man in his own image. That ain't what the world tells us. Why does the world tell us something different? The world tells us something different because if there is no God, then how did the world come about? How did it come about? Well, it had to take millions of years. I heard Bill Nye, the science guy. I heard him say something a couple of days ago and he was trying to say it as if it's amazing. He was telling a group of young people, he says, guys, we think that all creation is made by a creator. A watch, the world is not a watch. A watch was made by a creator. The world was made different than that. It wasn't made by a creator. It was made from the bottom up, not from a great creator who made the watch. See, that's his idea. That's what he believes. That is his theory. And so everything that an individual like Bill or other people who want to deny a God or deny a God as we understand it have to say, if there is no God, then there has to be another truth. So the Bible can't be right. There has to be another truth. And so creation wasn't created by a great creator. It was created from the bottom up. I was watching a TV show one time and they said something. They said that the woman's body is a evidence of evolution. And so I listened. And it said, the woman's reproductive reproduction process is evidence of evolution. Woman's reproduction is an evidence of evolution. They said this. They said, when the baby begins to grow inside the womb, it puts pressure on her lungs, which puts pressure on her heart. Her heart has to beat harder. It's harder for her to breathe. It's more difficult on her body because of that baby in her womb. Therefore, that is evidence of evolution. That's what they said. I am not too far off of almost exact words. And I thought to myself, how many people just heard that and went, I've never thought of that. Women's heart has to beat harder and their lungs, that pressure on their lungs causes issues, I guess. I've never thought about that being evidence of evolution. And they forget the fact that a man and a woman could create she could have a little egg, and the man could fertilize that little egg, and that little egg could all of a sudden become something in there called life. And she can raise that little thing up inside her and feed that child with her own abilities and deliver that child, have a natural ability to feed that child afterwards, and an innate ability to actually know what it means to be a mother when she's never done it before. But yet, it's a sign of evolution because her heart has to work harder and her lungs, and it puts pressure on her lungs. You see, all too often the world has tried to say, look, what the Bible has taught, a creator, a man who made man and women in high intelligence years ago in perfection, that's not right. We don't want to submit to a God. If there's a God, we have to submit. So therefore, we've got to then become our own gods, make up our own theories. Man was perfect. He was in God's image. And when I say perfect, perfect in love. Man was created in God's own image, high intelligence, high health, perfect health, critical thinkers, and perfect in love. In Genesis chapter 3, we begin to understand that the punishment for sin is death. Due to sin, the world is no longer perfect. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, it says this, for Adam said, this is talking to God after they have eaten of the fruit. Because he said to Adam, because you listened to your wife and ate the fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not to eat from. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground. Since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and dust you will return. In Romans 5:12 says this, by one man, sin entered the world, and death by sin. You see, what broke the perfection? It was sin. Sin is what broke the bind of perfection that we had here. There was no longer perfect love. There was no longer perfect harmony. There was no longer perfect health. And there was no longer perfect unity with God. Sheila asked me a long time ago. She said, if God intended man and woman to live together and to be husband and wife, why did he make them so different? And I thought to myself, that's a good question. But the answer came to me quite quickly. I said, Sheila, before the fall of man, my differences and your differences would create greatness. But after the fall of man, after sin entered the world, I use my differences to enhance myself, and you use your differences to enhance yourself, and it's no longer a perfect unity because it's all about me, myself, and I. There's no longer a perfect love and a perfect harmony, no longer perfect health and perfect relationship, unity with God. Why? Because of sin. You see, they walked with God in the cool of the garden. They enjoyed one-on-one fellowship with the Lord. But one day, a sneaky snake come up to Eve and said, did God really say you can't eat from that particular tree? And he began to entice her thinking. He said, you know what? God just don't want you to be like him and know good from evil. And she was tempted because she too wanted to all of a sudden be like God and understand the difference between good and evil. And because of that, she ate from the tree and she gave it to Adam. And because of that, sin then entered the world. Because of sin, evil now permeates our entire existence. One time I was, Allie had a 87 Sable, little old four-door car. James was always trying to buy it from her. And anyway, an old 87 Sable, and something died in there. And I could smell it. It permeated the entire car. If you was in the front seat, you could smell that dead something. If you were in the back seat, you could smell that dead something. And it's hard to find when an animal dies in your car, like a little mouse or something. It's very difficult to find because it permeates the entire car. Well, one day I was happened to be in that car and I'm thinking, God, that just stinks. And I had a few minutes and I thought, I'm just going to see if I could find it. And so I kind of get my old sniffer out and I'm sniffing around. And I think it's probably coming from the back. And so I open up the trunk and I can tell right where it's at. It's behind that ham or that turkey that's sitting in there. I can smell it. And I grab that turkey and I go to move it and it's mushy. You see, one time we were supposed to have 6 turkeys for our Thanksgiving dinner. And we only had 5 here. And one was in the back of that car for a couple of weeks. It permeated it. It permeated the entire car. So I sold it to James. But that's what sin does. That's what sin did. It permeated everything. Everything now was influenced and affected by sin. There is now selfishness, greed, and decay, and death. Understand this, nothing died. Nothing died before the fall of man. In Romans 5:12, we learn this, because of our mutual grandfather, Adam, because of his sin, we too now have sin in our lives. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all have sinned, we now suffer the consequences of Adam's and Eve's sin. We have a spiritual DNA that has a flaw in it now, and that flaw bends us towards selfishness, greed, taking what's not ours, lying, lust. And because of sin, there's death. Death of the body and death of the soul. It's because of sin that we die. It wasn't God's plan or will, but because of what Adam and Eve did, there's now death. Death of the body and death of the soul. We need to realize, church, that all of us are sinners now because of what took place so long ago. We are all sinners and in need of a Savior. Each one of us, I want you to understand, when I say that you are a sinner, I'm not saying you're a bad person. What I'm saying is you got an innate DNA inside of you with a natural born to sin. And an all-holy God cannot be with a sinful creature. Scripture says, how can dark and light be together? It can't. And God is all-holy. God is all-perfect. So, church, I want you to understand that whenever you are saved, you are saying, God, I understand that I have an innate flaw inside of me. I've got a sin nature that lives with inside of me. And I need a Savior to blot that sin. Because of sin in our lives, it causes separation between God and man. And that's when we need a Savior. Do we have a sin nature? Think about your child. You know, you tell little, we've got a little Johnny in here now, so I can't use that name no more. It's good to have little Johnny there. We have to call little Tommy. Little Tommy. You tell little Tommy, little Tommy, you leave those cookies alone. And you leave the room. What's little Tommy do? He goes gets them. And then you say, little Tommy, did you get that cookie? What's he say? No. How did he know that? Did anyone have to teach him how to lie? Did anyone have to teach him how to act that way? No, it's born in him. Carson a little more than the rest of us. It was just born in him. And we come to a holy Savior. And we say, God, I know I got a sin nature. I don't need a preacher to tell me that I've got a sin nature. But church, I want you to understand that sin nature comes from what took place so many years ago. It's innate inside us. And when we ask Christ to forgive us of our sins and be the Lord of our lives, what we're saying is, God, I don't want to be influenced by that sin nature no more. I give my life to the only Creator. I give my life to the only one who can bring salvation to a man who's broken. We need to understand we all need a Savior. It doesn't matter how good you've been. The most perfect moral person here will die and live a life and live eternity separated from the Lord because of your sin nature, not because of your morality. Romans 3:23 says this, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." We too have fallen. We have that selfishness. We have greed. We take what's not ours. We have a tendency to lie or have lust issues. We all have a sin nature. And because of that sin, we too will experience death someday. Death of the body. I'm almost done. My brother, it's his anniversary, like just right now, in the last couple of days of his death, 2 years ago. Randy passed away, and my aunt died on the same day, I guess. Yeah, she died just a couple of days ago, and I guess my aunt died on the same day as my brother. Death, it's just part of life. Because of sin, we too all will die someday. But there's also death of the soul. Because of the depth of the soul, that is eternal separation from a perfect God with perfect love for us. That's why, because of that perfect love for us, that's why you see scriptures like in Revelations where it says, "I stand at the door and knock. I want into your life. I want to be a part of your life. I want to forgive you for that sin that you have committed in your life. I want to forgive you that. I want to purify you. And I've sent my son, Jesus Christ, to die for the remission of your sin." You see, all the Old Testament points to a day when a Messiah would come, and the blood sacrifices of the animal, of the sheep, was a foreshadow of what would take place someday when that ultimate Savior would die for the forgiveness of our sins. The one who was perfect. It's a beautiful story, but all too often we take a beautiful story and we throw it to the side and we believe the lie that when we follow this beautiful Savior with a beautiful story, with a beautiful love, then somehow we're not, that we have sold out. And what we don't realize, whenever we follow this beautiful Savior with this beautiful love, with this beautiful story, with this beautiful passion and grace, when we don't follow Him, we're following a devil who has destruction and disgrace and despair in our future. But we think this is freedom and that's captivity. Church, following Jesus is not captivity. Following Jesus is freedom. We're free from that innate sin nature. Does that mean we're always perfect? No. We will all die with a need of a Savior. But because we said yes to Jesus, the Lord takes that old blood and He just pours it right over the top of us. Just like Riley did such beautifully just a little bit ago. That old person's dead and we're created new creatures in Christ. We're new. We're child of the King. Understanding we are not our own Savior. You see, we follow one of two gods. We either follow the God, Jesus Christ, we either follow Him or we say, "I am my own God." But when we are our own God, that only leads to death, an eternal separation from a holy God, an eternal life with the one who's deceived us. I want you to understand that we must trust in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We must trust. Romans chapter 10 verse 9 says this. If we declare with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, if we will believe in our hearts that He has raised Him from the dead, you too will be saved. Church, I want you to understand that there is an innate bent that we have in our lives. It's called sin. It's a sin nature. But Jesus Christ came and he fulfilled the penalty of that sin. And he said, just simply receive me. Or simply let me be your lead and your guide. Let me be the Lord of your life. And when you say goodbye to this world, you will stand in the presence of the Lord. But you've got to receive me. John 3:16 says this, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Church, that's the God that we serve, this one who wants to give us eternal life. But we can't follow two masters. We can't follow after the God of the devil and follow the God of the word. We can't follow after the devil's schemes and lies, but yet spend eternity in heaven. We will follow the one. We will live with the one that we follow. And if we want to follow the devil, then we will suffer the consequences where he ends up. Because that's the God we followed. Church, I don't want anyone to perish. I don't want anyone to end up where the devil ends up. I want us all to someday sing some of these great songs that we sing each and every Sunday up in heaven someday in our own Lone Star Cowboy church up there in heaven. Wouldn't that be fun? Joe Jack Tucker would probably sing us a few. Huh? I want us to be together in heaven someday. But you got to understand, you don't make it if you are your own God. Years ago, God created a perfect world. But that devil deceived. And he deceived Adam and Eve, and he has deceived us from that moment on. So the Lord comes down and he says, I'm going to make a final opportunity. Jesus, I want you to go down and I want you to live that perfect life because they can't do it. But your blood will be the remission of their sins. Church, I want to ask you tonight, today, do you need that Savior? Do you need to say yes to the Lord? Have you been your own God for far too long? Do you have a firm foundation that you are a child of the King? Our scriptures today didn't make it difficult or mystical. It said that those who simply acknowledge that you are the Christ. Simply open the door and let him come and be with you and you with him. Then you too will have eternity with the Lord in heaven. But you don't just have eternity with the Lord in heaven. You have an eternal walk even now as you walk with the Lord. And he leads and guides and he directs you. He begins to teach you new things. He begins to help you understand what it means to live for Jesus. And he helps you understand the consequences of sin. Do you need that Savior today? Do you need to say yes to the Lord? I want to give you that opportunity today. I'm going to share a prayer with you, and I'm just going to say it. I'll say it verbally, but you say it privately. This is not between you and your neighbor. This is between you and the Lord. Do you need that Savior today? The world tells us we don't. The world says, oh, throw all that away. You are your own God. But church, I don't see that. I see that I am a person who is in need of a Savior. I sometimes try to think I'm smart and more intelligent than everybody else. But ultimately, I'm humbled with the fact that I too need a Savior. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we just come before you today humbled. Lord, we are bombarded with people who are non-Christian, people who want to reject the gospel. And Lord, they dress fancy and they say big words. They show pie graphs and charts, make fancy backdrops, write history books. One day, evolution went from a theory to all sudden fact. And for the life of me, I don't know how it all sudden became fact when it was just theory. But Lord, our children now are bombarded with that. When I was a kid, It was taught as a theory, an idea. But now it's taught that it's fact. God, how as we as parents help defeat this lie? How do we defeat manipulation? How do we as Christians continue to point our kids to the gospel and the truth when they are so bombarded with non-Christian thinking? Help us, God, to do so. Lord, if there's anyone here today who is in need of a Savior, Lord, you are pounding on their heart's door. Father, it may have nothing to do with my message, but it has everything to do with life circumstances and what's been taking place in their life. And they know that there's something out there that they need. It's not some magic pill. It's not some all of a sudden perfection that we all of a sudden are perfect in everything we do. But we understand we are in need of a Savior. God, I pray that you would pound once more on that heart's door. That you'd yell through that door, hey, I'm here. And I love you. And I created a plan for you. And I have a hope and I have a future for you. But you've got to open that door. You got to let me be the God of your life. Lord, if there's one here today who needs to say yes to Jesus, God, I pray that you would give them a spiritual boldness that they've never had before. A spiritual hunger like they've never had before, where in their spirit they'd say, dear Heavenly Father, God, I know I need a Savior. I understand I have sin in my life. And I need a Savior. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me for that sin. And God, I pray that you would be my Lord. That you'd be my Savior. That you would walk with me and communicate with me. That you would help me understand what it means to be a Christian. But Lord, at this moment, I just want to say yes to you. Come into my life and be my Lord. I receive you. As you receive me, I accept you as you love me. And I say thank you. I say thank you for salvation that I receive at this moment. And I say thank you for the Holy Spirit that will lead me and guide me and direct me. And I say thank you for Jesus. Father, it's in your name I pray, my Lord and my Savior. In the name of Jesus, I ask all these things. Amen. God bless each of you. Go in the victory of the Lord. We talked about a few things, and I know your minds are going a million miles an hour on a few of them. Hey, here in about a month and a half, we're going to have a wonderful, wonderful speaker. I think you're going to find very, very interesting. Go on the cross of the Lord. Just as...